Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Today, you will hear stories from Andrew Smith, Jill Robbins, and me. Later, John Russell presents an everyday grammar lesson, one that Bob Dylan fans will especially enjoy. Then, Jill and Andrew return to bring us today's lesson of the day. But first, Japan is a nation so hard-working that the Japanese language has a term for working oneself to death. Now, the government is trying to deal with a labor shortage. One solution is to get more people and companies to accept 4-day work weeks. The Japanese government first supported a shorter working week in 2021. Few companies have signed on, however. The Ministry of Health, Labor, and Welfare said only about 8% of companies permit 3 days off a week, while 7% give their workers the required 1 day off. Hoping to get small and medium-sized businesses to change, the government started a work-style reform campaign. It pushes shorter hours and other flexible plans for work, along with paid time off and limits on overtime. The Labor Ministry recently started offering free services and resources to help companies make the change.
A ministry website explains the Hatarakikata Kaikaku campaign, which means innovating how we work. It says that when workers can choose how they work, they will have a better outlook on the future and the economy will grow. The department handling the new support services for businesses says only about 3 companies have asked for their advice. Such changes will not come easily in the Japanese culture, where being a workaholic, or frequently working overtime, has long been highly valued. That is credited for the country's national recovery and fast economic growth after World War II. There is great pressure to be the same as the others in one's work group. People usually take vacations at the same time of year as their co-workers. Although the law and labor agreements limit overtime, some work longer hours without pay. A recent government report dealt with karoshi, that is the Japanese term meaning death from overwork. The report said Japan has at least 54 such deaths a year, including from heart attacks.
Tim Craig wrote a book called Cool Japan, Case Studies from Japan's Cultural and Creative Industries. Work is a big deal here. It's not just a way to make money, although it is that too, said Craig. Some officials think it is time to change that way of thinking to save the workforce. Japan's birth rate continues to fall, and the work culture is said to be one reason for that. Government reports expect that, at the current rate, the working age population will drop by 40% to 45 million by 2065. Supporters of the 3-day-off model say it helps people remain in the workforce longer. It would give them more time to raise children and care for older relatives. For retirees living on retirement pensions, it would provide additional income. Akiko Yokohama works at Spell Data, a technology company that lets employees work a 4-day work week. She takes Wednesdays off, along with Saturdays and Sundays. The extra day off allows her to get her hair done, go to other appointments, or go shopping. Her husband works in real estate. He also gets Wednesdays off, but works weekends, which is common in his industry. Yokohama said that it lets her and her husband go on midweek family outings with their elementary school age child. But there are signs of change. A few companies, including Uniqlo, Ricoh, and Hitachi, have begun offering a 4-day work week.
A recent Gallup opinion study measured employee engagement. Gallup said Japan has among the least engaged workers of all nationalities it has studied. Only 6% of the Japanese who answered describe themselves as engaged at work, compared to the worldwide average of 23%. That means relatively few Japanese workers felt happy and highly involved in their workplace. Most were putting in their hours without investing passion or energy. Kaneko Ogino is president of Tokyo-based NS Group. She thinks offering flexible hours is needed for filling jobs in the service industry, where women are most of the workforce. The company offers 30 different scheduling patterns, including a 4-day work week, but also taking long periods off between work. To ensure none of the NS Group's workers feel out of place for choosing a different schedule, Ogino asks each of her 4,000 employees twice a year how they want to work. Voicing your own needs is disapproved in Japan, where you are expected to sacrifice for the common good. The view in Japan was, you are cool the more hours you work, putting in free overtime, Ogino said with a laugh. But there is no dream in such a life. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
Increasing amounts of ice have been melting on the continent of Antarctica over the past 10 years. Now, scientists are wondering if the increase in melting is temporary or if it will continue and perhaps melt even faster for years into the future. Nearly 1,500 experts who study Antarctica gathered in southern Chile last week to share results of their research. They discussed the extreme weather events that struck parts of the continent this year: heavy rainfall, unusually warm temperatures, and strong dry winds. The researchers say these events added to recent increases in melting. However, detailed weather data for Antarctica dates back only about 40 years. That is one reason climate scientists are unsure if the current melting is temporary or the beginning of a longer trend. NASA estimates show a possible 58-meter rise in the average worldwide sea level if all Antarctic ice melted. Studies have shown that about a third of the world's population lives below 100 vertical meters of sea level. Liz Keller is a paleoclimate specialist from the Victoria University of Wellington in New Zealand. She says scientists have never before seen Antarctic ice melting so quickly. She also spoke about the increasing amounts of carbon dioxide gas, CO2, in the Earth's atmosphere. You might see the same rise in CO2 over thousands of years, and now it's happened in 100 years, Keller said. Carbon dioxide traps heat in the atmosphere. Mike Weber is a paleooceanographer from the University of Bonn in Germany. He studies the movements of Antarctic ice over thousands of years. He said records dating back 21,000 years show at least 8 times when the ice melted quickly. He added that the data show the periods of ice loss sometimes lasted for hundreds of years. This led to much higher sea levels around the world. Weber said scientists want to know if the melting seen during the last 10 years has started a melting trend that will last for centuries. Maybe we're entering such a phase right now, he said. If we are, at least for now, there will be no stopping it. Some of the scientists in Chile agreed that the most harmful rise in sea level can still be avoided if fossil fuel emissions decrease. Weber noted that when glaciers melt, the Earth's land can rise because there is less weight pushing it down. Recent research suggests that if the melting does not happen too quickly, the rising land could nearly equal the rise in sea level. But if the melting happens too quickly, the rise in land could not meet the increase in sea level. If we keep emissions low, we can stop this eventually, said Weber. If we keep them high, we have a runaway situation, and we cannot do anything. Mathieu Casado is a paleoclimate and polar meteorologist at France's Climate and Environment Sciences Laboratory. He has examined ice from all over Antarctica to estimate temperatures dating back 800,000 years. Casado said that the last time the Earth was this warm was 125,000 years ago, and that sea levels then were 6 to 9 meters higher. He and other scientists said the speed and amount at which carbon is entering the atmosphere has never been so high. Gino Casasa is a glaciologist and head of the Chilean Antarctic Institute. He said that current estimates show sea levels rising by 4 meters by 2100 and more if emissions continue to grow. What happens in Antarctica doesn't stay in Antarctica, said Casasa, adding that global atmospheric, ocean, and weather systems are linked to the continent. I'm Andrew Smith.
Nobel Prize winner Bob Dylan is considered to be one of the best American songwriters. In today's everyday grammar, we will explore how Blowin' in the Wind, a famous Bob Dylan song, can teach you about English grammar. You will learn about question words, nouns, and more. Let's begin by listening to part of the song. Dylan's song has a group of questions, one after the other, followed by an answer. And consider these lines. Questions about count nouns make the base of Dylan's song. He does not sing about non-count nouns, he does not ask how much, and the answer to his questions is always the same. The next time you listen to any song in English, try to look for some kind of pattern. One way to think about Dylan's song is that it is about questions, answers, and count nouns. But other songs have different structures, ideas, and grammar points. By carefully studying songs, you can learn a lot about English grammar. I'm John Russell.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Hi, Gina. Did you hear Anna's having a party?
No, I didn't. It's this weekend?
Yes, and you just gave me an example of what I want to talk about today.
What are we talking about today?
Restating using intonation to clarify what you heard. And you did that by raising your voice at the end of a sentence, like this.
It's this weekend? So it's not really in the question form, where we usually change the order of the subject and verb. Instead, here we are using the same word order, but adding rising intonation to clarify we heard correctly. That's something really useful for people learning English, isn't it?
You bet. In Let's Learn English Lesson 10, we see Ashley going over to Anna's house.
Let me guess. She'll ask about how to get there?
You just did it again.
I'm really good at this. Let's listen.
Hi. Today, my friend Ashley is coming over. I am showing her my new apartment. Oh, that's Ashley calling.
Hi, Ashley.
Hi, Anna. I'm coming to your apartment. Where is your apartment? My apartment is near the Columbia Heights Metro.
It is near the Columbia Heights Metro?
Yes. Exit the metro and turn right. Then at the bus station, turn left. Then walk straight ahead.
How many times did you hear Ashley restate what she heard using rising intonation?
I think she did it twice.
It is near the Columbia Heights Metro?
And
exit metro, turn right, turn left, then go straight ahead.
I'm Gina Bennett, and you're listening to Voice of America's Learning English podcast. I think there's another good point we can teach from this lesson, Dr. Jill.
What's that, Gina?
The verb forms are all in the imperative. Sometimes we call it the command form. I get confused when someone gives me directions using a different form.
I know what you mean. So this is just the simple verb, no endings, exit, turn, go. Let's hear how Anna says it again.
Yes, exit the metro and turn right. Then at the bus station, turn left. Then walk straight ahead.
I noticed Anna tried to help Ashley with some more information, a landmark to look for. Listen to what she says about a coffee shop.
Okay, exit Metro, turn right, turn left, then go straight ahead?
Yes, my apartment is near a coffee shop.
Okay, see you soon.
Hi, Ashley.
Hello, Anna.
Which coffee shop? There are three coffee shops.
Okay, my apartment is across from a big department store.
A big department store? Ah, I see it.
Asked. Hey, Jill, did you notice? Ashley did that thing again with raising her voice at the end of a sentence to make sure she understood about the department store.
Hi, Ashley.
Hello, Anna.
Which coffee shop? There are three coffee shops.
Okay, my apartment is across from a big department store.
A big department store? Ah, I see it.
In the next lesson, lesson 11, we see Marcia is helping Anna find things in her neighborhood. There's the usual question you hear when someone is asking directions that begins with, where is?
Marcia, before we get ice cream, I need to return three books to the library. Where is the library?
It is on this street, on the corner.
That's right. You can ask that way, or you can use another expression. Anna needs to mail some letters, so she asks,
Anna, what are those in the book?
Marcia, these are letters to my family and friends back home. Four letters. Is there a post office near here?
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to Voice of America's Learning English podcast. Marcia helps Anna, but doesn't send her to the post office. Let's listen.
No, the post office is far from here. But there is a mailbox across from the store.
Awesome, let's go. Marcia, now I need to buy stamps.
Do you have cash?
No. Is there a bank near here?
There is a bank behind you.
Now I have cash. I can buy stamps.
That store sells stamps.
Wait here. I have stamps.
Wow, you're fast.
Thank you. Thank you, letters, for sending my words, my love, to my family and friends back home.
Do you have more cash?
I do.
Ice cream!
I love my new neighborhood. Everything is near our apartment, even hair salons and ice cream. Until next time!
I noticed she helped her with two things she needed, money and stamps.
That reminds me, Gina, are you driving to Anna's party on Saturday?
I plan to. Why? Do you need a ride?
You guessed it. That's another kind of question. I asked you a yes-no question, but I really wanted to ask for more information.
Like, your question leads to another one. Can you give me a ride? Sure, I'd be glad to, if you don't mind riding on the back of my motorcycle.
Sounds like fun. See you on Saturday.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.